Thank you. Hello everyone and hello from Malaysia. Welcome to our AIIMS Biotechnology Students Association webinar series. Thank you very much for your participation today. You have currently joined our webinar on mushroom, taboos, myths, mysteries, and beyond. We will begin our program shortly. I would like to kick off today's program by reminding you of some of the housekeeping items as seen on the screen. First of all, please turn off your microphone during the session and only unmute when you are required to speak. Please turn on your camera so that we can see each other. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to message us through the chat box. We will try our best to address your concerns. The chat box is also there for you to introduce yourselves, so please give us your name and your organization. Last but not least, no phone calls or disruptions during the session. Note that this session will be recorded and live on YouTube. The recording will be saved on our YouTube channel right after the session. An evaluation survey will appear at the end of our session. Please take some time to provide your feedback as it will be really meaningful for us to improve our next session. Thank you very much for your attention. And once again, welcome to our webinar organized by AIIMS Biotechnology Students Association. My name is Renu Priya, and I'm proud to tell you that I'm a biotechnology degree student at AIIMS University. It is a great honor for me to serve you as the MC for this webinar. If anyone has any issues with the audio or video, please use the chat box and we will do our best to help you. To start the session, I would like to invite Mr. Hugo, the APSA president, to deliver his welcoming remarks.
Thank you, Renu. Hello, everybody, and hello from Malaysia. I hope that you all had a wonderful Christmas celebration. Our honorable speaker of the day, Assistant Professor Dr. Prasad Lamrut from Ahmednagar College of India, Senior Professor Menakem Ravichandran, the Dean of our Faculty of Applied Sciences from AIIMS University, our very supportive APSA advisor, Senior Associate Professor, Dr. Subhash, professors, lecturers, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us. On behalf of the AIIMS Biotechnology Student Association, I welcome you all. I'm glad to see all of you here, though it's virtually. I'm delighted to tell you that we have over 100 registered participants from 6 different countries. We have participants from Malaysia, Australia, Myanmar, India, Japan, as well as Libya. This is our second webinar as a part of our APSA webinar series. As an association of students, APSA, we always strive to provide a quality and comprehensive social platform to AIIMS University biotech and bioinformatics students to help them grow, to help them learn new things, and to have fun in the process. So far, we have organized numerous activities. This includes the annual sport event, APSA Olympics, Faculty Prom Night, undergraduate orientation, to name a few. In this modern era and ever-growing field of biotechnology, our intellectual capacity is essential, but not everything. Our soft skills are equally important. No matter whether you are a researcher, entrepreneur, patent agent, or writer after your graduation. Therefore, APSA, we have started this webinar series, and all of our members will get opportunity to organize the webinars in the series. Our webinar series main goal is to provide a platform for the students to develop and refine their various soft skills, such as leadership, teamwork, communication, interpersonal skill, event organization, and management. At the same time, these webinars will help APSA members and participants to update themselves. Last but not least, I would like to thank the organizing committees for doing a splendid job. I saw the efforts they put in to make this webinar into a reality. They worked productively even on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day itself, conducting dry runs and discussion. And I would also like to thank Dr. Prasad for taking your time and becoming a part of our webinar series. I'm sure that we all will learn something new from today's webinar. I would also like to extend my thanks to Dr. Subhash, our advisor. Thank you for advising the webinar organizing committee. accompanying us from scratch to hatch. Once again, thank you, everyone. Ms. Reynu, over to you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hugo, for the wonderful welcoming remarks. Next, I would like to invite the Dean of Faculty of Applied Sciences, Senior Professor M. Ravichandran, to deliver his opening remarks.
A very good morning to all of you. It is a wonderful program organized by AIIMS Biotechnology Student Association. It's the second event, and very glad to see the enthusiasm and the protocol followed by the students, mentored by Dr. Subhas. I think congratulations to all of you. Let's welcome our speaker, Dr. Prasad. I think thank you so much for your time. Very attractive title. And I just want to tell you all, we have signed an MOU with Amana College, and we have we also organized the international conference in collaboration with them. And we appreciate the collaboration from Amana College. And thank you, Dr. Prasad, for giving a very nice topic, you know, mushroom one. It's very rare to hear that. And I would like to thank once again the organizing committee members and for the excellent effort taken. And wish you all Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. Over to...
Thank you very much, Professor Ravichandran, for your inspiring opening remarks. Next, I would like to call upon the organizing committee chairperson, Ms. Shasha, to say a few words and to introduce the moderator of today's webinar. Ms. Shasha, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ms. Renupriya. Greetings of the day to all of you. I am Shasha Sohaimi, and I am proud to tell you that I am a second-year student of the BSc Honours in the Biotechnology Degree Program of AIIMS University in Malaysia. It was an honour to serve as the chairperson of the organising committee to organise this webinar. On behalf of the organising committee, I welcome today's speaker, Dr. Prasad Wellamrud, who is an assistant professor in the Department of Botany, Ahmadnagar College, Ahmadnagar, Maharashtra, India, the Dean of our faculty, Senior Professor M. Ravichandran, the moderator, Ms. Chai Hoi Chi, and all the participants of this webinar. This is the second webinar of our APSA webinar series organized by AIIMS Biotechnology Students Association, and we are proud to host it. As chairperson, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to our committed team who worked hard to organize this webinar. Thank you, Dr. Prasad, for accepting our invitation and becoming a part of our webinar series. Thanks to the Dean of our faculty, Senior Professor M. Ravichandran, for attending the webinar and supporting APSA. I want to extend my thanks to Mr. Hugo, the President of APSA, and Ms. Vivian, Vice President of APSA, for facilitating and organizing this webinar. Last but not least, I want to especially thank our Senior Associate Professor, Dr. Subhas. Our committee members are lucky to have him as the advisor for APSA. He has guided my team throughout the process for making this webinar a reality. I thank Dr. Subhas for his guidance and molding us to play these roles. His determination to help and see his students excel is truly appreciated. Once again, I welcome you all and thank you for joining us. Ms. Renupriya, over to you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Shasha. Now, I would like to request the moderator, Ms. Chai Hoi Chi, to take charge of the webinar and to introduce the presenter, Dr. Prasad. Over to you, Ms. Chai.
Thank you very much, Reynu. Hello, everyone. My name is Chai Hui Chi. I'm proud to tell you that I'm a BSc Biotechnology Year 2 student at AIIMS University. It is my honor to serve as the moderator for this webinar. I am pleased to become a part of this webinar event. As the moderator of this session, I welcome you all. Thank you for joining us. So today's webinar topic is very interesting and important. We see many mushrooms around our house during the rainy season. And because of their different colors and shapes, we get excited. And mushrooms are important for several reasons. And mushrooms are a good source of nutrients and minerals. Nowadays, more people are concerned about their diets. And mushrooms are rich in nutrients, and it is a multi-billion dollar industry around the world. So you all might be curious to know how to grow mushrooms. And do you think raw mushrooms is really poisonous to us? And how many mushroom species on the earth are discovered and edible? And how mushrooms are useful to diabetic people? With all these questions popping up in our minds, we all are very excited to listen to the talk of our today's speaker, Dr. Prasad. It is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Prasad. Currently, Dr. Prajak is working as assistant professor at Department of Botany of Ahmednagar College, which is located in Maharashtra, India. His research interests are in medicinal mushrooms, mushroom cultivation, ethnomycology, fungal biotechnology, taxonomy, and phylogenetics. He has completed research projects funded by University Grants Commission of India. He has presented over 35 papers in national and international conferences. He writes popular articles in local newspaper and delivers talks to heterogeneous audience to popularize mushroom. He working with NGOs like Ranwa and Ahmednagar District Biodiversity and Conservation Center. Currently, he is working on diversity and ethnomycologically important mushrooms of Ahmednagar. He has published over 35 research papers in national and international peer-reviewed journals. With this little bit background, I would like to request Dr. Prasad to take the floor's charge and start the presentation. Dr. Prasad, the floor is yours, please.
Yes, thank you very much. And good morning to all from Ahmednagar, India. At the onset, I would like to thank all the faculties and the authorities of AIIMS University, Senior Professor, Mr. Dr. Ravichandran, my friend, Dr. Subhash, and all the organizing committee members for giving me this opportunity to share some of my work or thoughts with you. Well, of course, it is glad that you found this topic very interesting. And over the years, I have realized while speaking with many students or scientists or local people that the awareness about the mushroom is very much lacking for the fungi also. And when we talk about the mushrooms or the fungi, we think that they are obnoxious, they are harmful. So I'll be speaking in a very general aspect, not going into the very technical jargon. And of course, I will not be speaking how to grow the mushrooms or like that stuff, but very less known aspects of the mushrooms. What are the myths? Are they really myths? What are the taboos? Are they really taboos? And etc. So with your permission, I would like to share my screen and I will start the presentation. Yes, is it visible? And am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Prasad.
So I purposely put this slide. Why? Why this topic? Like I said before, I had the opportunity to do the field works in different parts of India, especially in the southern India, in Maharashtra, the place where I live. And I had a chance to speak with the tribals, the local communities. Even for the last year, we undertook a survey about the mushroom awareness in Ahmednagar city amongst the different communities. So we put a questionnaire and we gathered the data. And what we realized that the awareness is very meager, is very less. And there are many taboos or misconceptions are there in the minds of the people concerning the mushroom. Most of the people, they think that the mushrooms are poisonous. Even we look at the mushroom or even we touch the mushroom, we are going to die. Or if we consume the mushroom, we are going to die. So then I took this challenge to popularize the mushroom. Like some of you have correctly said that the mushrooms are rich in nutrients. And you name the disease, you have the cure with the mushroom. And there is a lot of research is ongoing on the different facets of the mushroom. And even there are books are available, of course, but these books mainly speaks about how to grow the mushroom, what are the different conditions that are required, what are the different substrates that are required, and only few lines describing the mushrooms that are used in the prehistoric time or in the ancient times by the Greeks and Romans and whatnot. And we are not generally aware what mushrooms have played the role in various religions or various cults, etc. So that is why the today's topic is mushrooms, taboos, myths, mysteries, and beyond. So to begin with, let us discuss what are the mushrooms. Because there are again different taboos are there, which I'll be discussing in a short while. Basically, mushrooms are nothing but the fungi. The fungi that constitutes a very large group of organisms. So it is considered as second large group after the insects. And these fungi can be found literally everywhere in every ecological niche. You name the area, you will find the fungi that is growing. So the fungi over the period of evolution have developed the ability to produce different kinds of enzymes which are able to utilize the substrate. Even you will find the fungus growing in a high contaminated area or radiation contaminated area, or even on a camera lenses which are at most devoid of any nutrients. So fungi also shows what is called oligotrophy. They can be grown in absence or near absence of the nutrients. And this ability made the fungus, you can say, conquer the world. And another important aspect of the mushroom, that or rather fungi, is recycling, especially recycling of lignocellulosic waste, which is generated each and every day. Agricultural wastes are there, or the leaves, fruit fall, or branches that they fall, but all that get recycled due to the fungus. And this is the analogy which I have made, that this is a Indian mythological god, three gods, Brahma, Vishnu, and Mahesh. And each of the god has assigned a particular job. Like Brahma has, it is believed that Brahma has created the world, the Vishnu is nurturing the world, whereas the Lord Shiva is a destructor, is a recycler. And this fungus is doing the same thing. Now, why I'm telling you this? Because there are some mythological references are there, which perhaps I'll show it to you later on. So this is the most important activity that fungus is doing. And because of the fungus, we are here on the surface of the earth. Otherwise, it is said that had the fungus been not there, the human beings have engaged only in the dumping of the leaves and burning of the leaves for the rest of their lives. But we don't have to do that. The fungus is taking care. Of course, some part is shouldered by bacteria and insects, but large part is taken over by the fungus because of the lignocellulosic activity. They have the enzymes. So the fungus exhibit different kinds of activities. They show different lifestyles, metabolic activities, morphological structures. There are tiny structures are there. And this is a very versatile kingdom. And one of the forms of the fungus is a mushroom. Or if I have to say in a simpler words, the mushrooms are nothing but the fruit bodies of the fungus or fruit bodies of the fungi. And the mushrooms, they mainly grow by means of a thread-like vegetative structures, which we call them as hyphae or hypha, or they get together to form a network, which is called mycelium. And these mycelium, they get aggregated to form what is called the mushrooms. So these are the mycelia. This is the scanning electron micrograph of the mycelial network. And this is how the mycelia get combined, clubbed together to form the mushrooms. So on the right hand bottom, there is a substrate on which you can see thread-like structures. These are all mycelia. In due course of time, when the nutrients get depleted, the mycelia gets into the reproductive phase and they form these mushrooms, and then reproduction takes place, the spore dispersal takes place, and the next generation starts. So analogically, if you consider mycelia, or mycelia is nothing or analogous to the trees, and the trees produces fruits, here the mycelia produces the mushroom. So this is a sort of simple analogy to make you understand what is a mushroom. Now, what is the meaning of the term mushroom? Of course, there are two contexts are there, but basically the term mushroom was previously used to denote a typical umbrella-like shape which has a circular cap and a central stalk or stem. And this term mushroom always comes with the term what is called toadstools. And both these words are dating about, English words dating about 15th century back, and they literally do not have a precise meaning. But of course, there is a general notion that when you use the term mushroom, it is used to denote the edible species that you get in the supermarkets, or there are local cultivators are there. And I believe that Volvariella volvacea is more popular in Malaysia, if I'm not wrong. Which we call it as a paddy straw mushroom. Even in India, on the northern side, there is a Agaricus, and they have now started cultivating shiitake. In Maharashtra, there is a Pleurotus, different species of Pleurotus. In the South India, we have Volvariella. So you have different mushrooms which are grown, and they are edible. Whereas the toadstool term is generally used to indicate the poisonous species of the mushroom. So on your right hand side, there is a Amanita muscaria, and your left hand side, there is a edible mushroom, that is Agaricus bisporus. So this toadstool, of course, has nothing to do with the toad sitting on the top of the mushroom or underneath the mushroom. But this refers, or this is this comes from a German word, which meaning the death stool. That means if one consumes such mushrooms, they will get poisoned. Of course, the person will not die. Again, that is another taboo. Perhaps I'll talk about this later. And like I said, there are two contexts are there when you talk about the mushrooms. In the British context, the term mushroom is restrictedly, or it is narrowly used to denote the species of Agaricus only. There are different species of Agaricus which are edible. There are some species which are poisonous. So Agaricus bisporus, which is very much known. Then Agaricus blazili, that is another edible medicinal mushroom. Whereas in American context, this term is applied to any gill-bearing structure. So the curtain-like structure that you see here, these are all gills. So whatever gill containing structures that are there, the American context says that is a mushroom. Over the period of, so these are the different kinds of mushrooms. Now over the period of time, the term mushroom has spread to a wider horizon. And this term includes different macromycetes belonging to the different classes or orders. This is the middle one is a Geostrum. This is Cucania. This is Phalaenus. You have the Sarcocypha, Osroi, and all that. Very interesting. And this is a very beautiful paper. It's available on the net, which is telling about the origins of the word mushrooms. So there are different possibilities which are proposed by this author. So if you have a time, you can go through that book. It is usually considered that the word mushroom comes from the old French word mucilon, and which is abbreviated or get changed to mushrooms. So this is a working definition, I can say, which is proposed by Chang and Miles. Of course, many of the scientists, they have opposed this definition, but for the time being, we can say that this is a working definition of a mushroom. So basically it is a macrofungus. Macro means large, which has a distinctive fruiting bodies, which can be either hypogeous, means below the ground, or epigeous, above the ground, large enough to be seen with the naked eye and to be picked by. These are mushrooms. Epigeous means they are growing on the tree, on the substratum, on the ground, like you have Wolveriella volvacea, auricula mushroom, which is Wood's ear or Judah's ear mushroom, and on the right hand bottom, you have a hypogeous. These are the tubers or truffles. They are ectomycorrhizal fungi. They are forming an association with the roots of basically conifers found in temperate areas. And interestingly, and initially, to find these mushrooms, of course, these are very highly edible, high-priced edible mushrooms are there, which are used in the Italian cuisine. And to search these mushrooms, initially pigs were used. But the problem was these mushrooms, they emit the odor similar to that of the female pig. And therefore, the pig would dig up these mushrooms and eat the mushrooms. And then the person will not have the money by selling these mushrooms. So nowadays, sniffer dogs are used. They sniff the trail of the mushroom and the owner digs out the mushroom and sells the mushroom. The mushrooms are of different sizes. There are small mushrooms are there. This is Merasmius. There are medium-sized mushrooms are there. And there are large mushrooms are there. Very large. Now the taboos. I don't know if it is there or not, but in Maharashtra, where the place I live, it is believed that the mushrooms, they grow when the dogs, they urinate. Or the mushrooms, they grow because of the cows, the crow's excreta. But that is not true. Being a science student, you must know that the mushrooms, they produce spores. The spores germinate and they produce mycelia. The mycelia aggregates and they produce mushrooms. So that is one of the taboos which is very much there in the minds of the students or the even science people which are working here. Well, I don't know if the similar taboo is there in Malaysia or not, but that is not true. Now, as far as mushrooms are concerned, you have two feelings which are worldwide. Either you fear the mushrooms or you love the mushrooms. So you have a mycophobia. There are communities are there which are mycophobic. And this mycophobia is right from there since ancient times, which is lasted even to the date in modern eras. The mushrooms are usually thought that they arose from nowhere. Suddenly you see mushrooms and then you wonder from where the mushrooms has come. In certain parts of India, the mushrooms are considered as the spirits of the ancestors. Especially there's one mushroom which I'm going to show you later on, Xyleria. It is thought that they are thought to arise after the dog's urination, or they are the spirits of the ancestors which have come to the earth in the form of mushrooms. And therefore, these mushrooms, they carry a very hideous name or very strange name in Marathi, that is local language here, that is Kutrachi Chhatri. Kutra means dog and Chhatri means umbrella. So dog's umbrella. Or in Hindi, it is called Kukarmuta. So, or Kavlachi Chhatri. Kavla means crow and Chhatri is umbrella. So, even you have names like dog's belly or donkey's fungus or frogs, etc., etc. So, they carry very hideous and strange names. Similarly, the Xyleria, which I mentioned, is known by the name Dead Man's Finger because of the shape of the fruit bodies. Even some other names are Leg of Francolin and etc. So this is what is Xylaria. It looks like a hand or a toe of a ghost or a demon or a, so that is why it is Dead Man's Finger. Now, mentioning about the mushrooms, there are some poems, there are some thoughts are there, right from the Nicander, right from the Greeks and Romans. And Nicander, in his poem, Alexi Pharmaca, about 185 BC, referred that, let not evil ferment the earth, which you can read that. Similarly, this went on, and Greek medicinal writer Dioscorides, he divided first time the mushrooms into edible and poisonous. And he wrote that, that are deadly and split them, that eateth of them, and be called to do stools, and the others do not. So the one which causes death are called toadstools, and the others, they are edible. And moreover, it said that the edible mushrooms and poisonous mushrooms, basically they grow among the rusty nails or rotten rags or eye holes of a serpent. So basically all these poisonous mushrooms, they are growing in the snake mound or termite mound or maybe the wood where the serpent are living, etc. So all these mushrooms are they he considered as the poisonous. Then Galen, of course, all these are Greek and Roman entities. So he was a medicinal practitioner, and he mentioned the mushrooms as cold and moist in nature, venomous and full of poison. So this is one of the taboos. Still we have this, that each and every mushroom is poisonous. Then a German herbalist in 1552 was very curious to know about the nature of the fungus. So he said that the fungi and truffles are neither herbs, nor toxic, nor roots, nor flowers, nor seeds, but may be the superfluous moisture of earth. So he considered that the mushrooms are nothing but it's a moisture of earth. And from the moisture of the earth, the fungus and the truffles that grow, or the rotten wood or other rotten things generates the mushroom. Similarly, in olden days, there was a fear about bioluminescent mushrooms, which are nowadays used extensively biotechnologically. There are genes, they are identified, and they are used to prepare the bioluminescent plants, or maybe to trace the cancer, because they emit the fluorescence and that can be tracked back. Similarly, the famous poet Shelley, he wrote one very beautiful poem on the mushroom, which you can later on read, because we have a lack of time. Okay, then the myths. The first question, are they really myths, or is there any scientific knowledge or scientific notion is there behind those myths? Now, this is a very famous picture which entitled as Fungus Man and the Raven. So this person to your left with a paddle is a fungus man, and the right hand side is a raven, who was the fungus man created from the tree biscuits, and he helped the raven to create the woman. And these myths are generated because another feeling about the mushroom, that is mycophilia, that is affection. So there are communities are there which are more mushroom liking. They like the mushrooms, and it is said that the throughout the Asia, much of the Europe, Poland and Russia, the people are much mycophilic. They consume more mushroom. And of course, all these are well documented, and I have taken them from the various literatures. It's not my own telling. Similarly, it says that the mushrooms are permitted to eat on Fridays, because on that particular day, some communities are forbidden to eat the meat. So the taste of a mushroom is more like that of the meat. So you can have alternate to the meat. And amongst the mycophilic cultures, the perhaps most of the fascinating aspects of the uses of mushrooms would be related to the religion and mythology. And that is why I have shown the picture of the three deities, Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh. And of course, there are many lot of literature is available on the net. There are books are available. And unfortunately, India also had a rich tradition or legacy of the mushroom, but over the period of time, it has been forgotten. And fortunately, with one of the groups I am associated with, we are working to find out the roots of mushroom in the Indian mythology or Indian literature, etc. And that mycophily extended further, and the people, they started worshipping the mushrooms, which is called mycolatry. So the first and foremost is about the Egyptians. The Egyptians, they considered the mushrooms as a gift from the god Osiris, whereas the Romans, they considered that it is the food of the gods. The gods are only permitted to eat the mushrooms. They also believe that the mushrooms arose resulting from the bolts of lightning, which is thrown by the Greek god Jupiter during the thunderstorm. And if you search the net, you will also find a very beautiful paper that Amanita Muscari and the Thunderbolt Legend. So they have tried to correlate such stories with the Amanita Muscari. Whereas the Chinese, they treated them as an elixir of life. The Chinese, they eat a lot of mushrooms. There are a lot of industries are there, and it is the leading exporter of the mushrooms all over the world. And in the Materia Medica, Chinese Materia Medica, whatever 10, 12 superior herbs that are mentioned, the number one herb is Ganoderma lucidum or Ling Zi or Ling Qi, it is called. And similarly, Indian culture, we have believe that it is the holy drink of God or Soma, Somaras. Of course, there are many candidates are considered as Soma, but Robert Gordon Wasson and many more scientists, they studied the hymns of the Rigveda, and they compared whatever is described in those hymns with the mushroom, and they tried to prove that this Soma mushroom is, or Soma is nothing but it is the extract of Amanita muscaria. Similarly, the native people of Mexico and Guatemala, they believe that the fly agaric mushroom, that is Amanita muscaria, grows because of the thunder and lightning, which is very much similar to the belief of the Greeks and Romans. And these are the mysteries. All over the world, you will find these rock paintings or rock carvings. So you can find here, there is a large person which is shown holding a mushroom-like structure in his left hand. So, of course, the oldest record about the mushroom was in the city of Pompeii, which was buried in the volcanic eruptions. Similarly, the oldest known illustration about the fungi is made in Romans. The people in the early centuries were curious about the origin and the nature of the mushrooms. Pliny, he was confused about the nature of the fungus and mentioned that they were earthly concentrations and imperfections. Similarly, Greeks believed that the truffles originated from the thunder. And this is a very peculiar finding. His name is Ötzi, or Iceman. He was found in Alps somewhere. And the scientists, they discovered, and his belongings were scrutinized. A lot of work is ongoing to find, understand his structure. And so this is how it was discovered. And this fellow was found with the bag. And when they scrutinized the bag or the contents of the bags, they found some mycelia-like structure. And in 2001, there is a paper was published on the content of the bags. And they found that this bag contains the pieces of mushrooms, Piptoporus betulinus and Fomes fomentarius. Now the question arose why he must have used these fruit bodies. So it is believed that these mushrooms or these fruit bodies might have used by him as a tinder to start a fire or to keep the fire for the longer time. So Ursula Pentner and his associate, they discovered this Piptoporus betulinus and Fomes fomentarius. Of course, like I mentioned, as far as mycolatry and religious used or mythological aspects are concerned about the mushroom, lot of literature and lot of stone paintings or cave paintings are found in the Mayan civilization. And lot of excavation took place, and they found lot of evidences strongly suggesting the existence of mushroom cult, where the mushrooms were worshipped. Similarly, they found an image or painting in Algeria. I'll show you that painting a little while. So these are how the mushroom stones were discovered, which were thought to be worshipped by the Mayan people in Guatemala, Mexico. Then these are another paintings. So left hand top, there's a person holding mushroom like structure. So it is a Mexican god, which is called Prince of Flower or Xochifili, and he is holding the mushroom. On the right hand side, there is a person who is eating the mushroom, and there is a demon-like structure. And it is interpreted that this demon-like structure is basically a god, and he is protecting the person from the ill spirits. So if you eat the mushroom, that god will protect you from the ill spirits. So that was the notion. And these are the some of the mushroom-like stones or sculptures that were discovered. Similarly, these are the rock paintings from the Russia. So you have humanoids with the mushroom cap on the head. So that is a mystery. Why these structures are shown, or why the people are shown with the mushroom-like structure holding, or why these stones are carved. So that is a mystery. Even these are the mushroom people. So there are humanoids with a mushroom head, mushroom-like head, which are running. This is found in the Sahara, Tassil in Ajir region of Sahara. Yeah. Then this is another wall painting, which is from the France. And the two figures are the Adam and Eve. And we know that they ate the apple, or they ate the fruit, and they made a sin. They came to the earth, and then we, the humans, were created. So the scientists, they tried to they proved that the fruit actually was a Amanita muscaria, or whatever this tree, the knowledge of good and evil, or fruit of the tree, is basically Amanita muscaria. Now that was the cave image that was discovered. Now this is a shaman, basically. A shaman, what is a shaman? Shaman is nothing but, it is a spiritual leader of a tribe, which connects and he is wearing a bee mask and holding mushrooms in his hands. And similarly, he has mushroom-like structure all over his body. So what is the reason why he is holding the mushroom, and why he has shown such mushroom-like caps all over his body? Now, you can recognize this very well. And it is shown, of course, all the deities or saints, they are shown with an aura. So here, this aura is shown like a mushroom. So you can see the gills or the curtain-like structures here. And of course, there is a lot of literature is there on the net, or there are books are there comparing Jesus with that of the Amanita muscaria. Even Santa Claus and Amanita muscaria, or Moses and Amanita muscaria. So that is there. Then this is the mushroom symbols, which are carved on the walls of one of the temples of the Egypt hieroglyphs. One is shown red, the other is blue, or you can have also this mushroom-like symbols. What is the reason why such symbols are there? Of course, these symbols are not deciphered. Their meaning is not known. I forgot to put another picture here. Recently, we found that such mushroom-like symbols are also being used in the script of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. So we are working on that. We are trying to decipher the meaning. And they have been found to be carved on everywhere, like pots or bangles, or bas reliefs and all that. So there are mushroom-like symbols are carved even in Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. Perhaps you are aware of that. So this is how the symbols were carved. Then this is a deity, and he is holding a mushroom-like structure. This is a Hindu deity, Hari Hari. I think this photograph is from Cambodia. So he is holding a mushroom-like structure. Or this is another bas relief. Now here, a phallus-like structure is shown, which represents the male, and a mushroom cap-like structure, which represents the female. And both they unite in a form of universal process of creation. So, and there are nymphs are there, which are worshipping such mushrooms. Then this is the mushroom stone from the Kerala, which is there, called as Kudakkalu. Now, what is the mystery? Why such mushroom stones are there everywhere in certain places of Kerala, which is not known. There are some postulates are there that this may be a portal for the another world. Some says that it may be just a place where you keep your grains and food stuff, so that will get preserved for the longer time. So there are various postulates are there, but exact meaning and exact reason is still not known. So about this very interesting and less known fact, basically the reason why these mushrooms figures or pictures are there, because of the psychedelic nature of the mushroom. There are few mushrooms which are psychedelic, like many species of psilocybin. Then you have Amanita muscaria, Paniolus, Coplandia. And there is another, you can say, ritual, or there is a practice of consuming such psychedelic mushrooms. So when you eat those mushrooms, you go in a trance. And based on your experience, you get some enlightenment. Fortunately, there are many case studies and references are available. A lot of work is ongoing. So basically, because the mushrooms psychedelic activity, you get a spiritual experience. It was known to the older or ancient peoples, and that is why everywhere they have depicted these mushrooms, or they have given the pictures of the mushrooms. And the mushrooms are also called as flesh of the gods because of this reason. So with this, come back to the modern world. Of course, there are many aspects are there where the mushrooms are used everywhere, or fungi are used everywhere. You all are biotechnology students. And one fungus which is very popular, that is Saccharomyces cerevisiae yeast, isn't it? You use the plasmid, or you use the chromosome for the transgenic, isn't it? Yeast artificial chromosome, YAC. And another biotechnological aspect of the Saccharomyces cerevisiae is winemaking. Winemaking is known since ancient times, since the times of the Egyptians. And in olden days also, we had a very good rapport with Iran and India, where Iranian wines were imported to the India. So the knowledge of the fungus is not very new. It was known since the ancient times. Now, these are some of the aspects where you can find the use of mushroom. Of course, each aspect makes a separate topic. One can speak about each and every aspect for more than 1 hour. At least I can speak. That much literature is available. So basically, mushrooms can be used for the consumption, edible, decoration, environment, for solving the crime, medicine, colors, bias prospecting, criminal investigation, and likewise. So let us go quickly. So these are different dishes made of mushrooms. There are about 1100 different mushrooms are used worldwide, and out of that, most of them, they are wild. Out of that, roughly 25 species are commercially cultivated and they are exported. And notably, Agaricus bisporus, Lentinula edulis, that is shiitake, Volvaria volvacea. Then you have Auricularia, Auricularia jedi, Boletus. Then you have Armillaria, and there are so many species are there. Marshalla is there, and various dishes are prepared. This is another mushroom. This Dongarwadi, that is a place from Pune, 150 kilometers away from the place where I live. Then Kodagu, that is Kerala, Karnataka, one of the states of or districts of Karnataka, that is in South India. And there's a practice of consuming this mushroom in Japan. There are some tribals are there which dry this mushroom and they consume this mushroom. The old name was Dictyophora. Now it has been changed to Phallus. And these are the, some of the products that are there in the supermarkets. Of course, in Ahmednagar, we do not have these products except for the fresh mushrooms. Maybe you have such products in Malaysia. I don't know. So, like some of you have said, that the mushrooms are a source of good quality proteins, edible proteins, digestible proteins, plus many vitamins, especially the B complex, vitamin C, carbohydrates are there, a lot of fibers are there. Then you have essential amino acids, amino sugars are there, less lipid contents, less sodium content, and all that makes the mushroom more nutritious, and you can have these mushrooms to solve the protein malnutrition which many of the countries are facing now, or we will perhaps face after a few decades. Similarly, not only in Africa, but in many of the countries, the mushrooms serve as an income generation. So this is all termitomyces, which is collected from the termite mound and sold at a high price. Even in Maharashtra, different places like Kokan area, Western Ghats, we say, toward the Vidarbha, Nagpur side, another place, the tribals, they collect the mushrooms and they sell on the roadside. So these are from the Mexico or China, etc. So this is how you find. I have seen once selling of mushroom in somewhere, Nashik, that is near to Ahmednagar, maybe 160-180 kilometers. So one of the tribal girl, she was selling the mushrooms. Then for the decoration, this is a species of polyporous. You can use it for the decoration, or you can have such figures, light lamps, or on the necklaces or dish. This is Ganoderma. This is also called as artist conch. This is the lower surface. The pictures are drawn because of the oxidation. It turns the brown or dark brown in color. So you can have such pictures drawn on the back side of the mushroom, and you can sell it as a decorative article. Now, as far as environment is concerned, the mushrooms or the mushroom mycelia, well, I'm giving you a very brief idea because of the time constraint. Bioabsorption of heavy metals, especially in the wastewater, in the industrial water, if you want to remove the traces of heavy metals, conventional methods are there, but nowadays the use of mushroom mycelia has become more popular. It can absorb the heavy metals even if they are in a trace amount, ppb level, parts per billion level. Then coal solubilization, industrial effluent treatment, lignocellulose conversion, mushroom cultivation is a big industry. Most of the agricultural waste is converted into edible protein. Then bioremediation, the different types of mushrooms or spores, they are mixed to bioremediate, to bring the wasteland into on a fertile conditions, to remove the heavy metals or maybe undissolved fertilizers, phosphates and sulfates, etc. So for that, the fungi are used or mushrooms are used. Then detective, to solve the crime, the cadaver decomposition, taphonomy, likewise. So basically, when the body starts decomposing, we have a lot of proteins. The proteins also decomposes, and we know that the protein, one of the components is NH3, that is ammonia, isn't it? So when the proteins start decomposing, a lot of ammonia is liberated, and that makes the surrounding more ammonia rich. And there are few species of mushrooms that prefers to grow in such ammonia rich environment. And then the scientist or the workers, they thought, why not use this ability to solve the crime? Suppose if I kill somebody and if I bury the corpus in the jungle, and if the police deputes a detective, and if a detective has the knowledge of these mushrooms, and if he locates a particular mushroom, then maybe we can discover the body. Of course, the preliminary study has been done on the corpus of dogs and cats, not on the humans, of course. So this is another avenue to work or research to solve the crime. And this is very wonderful paper, which was appeared in the Mycologist, Mushrooms and Taphonomy, the fungus that marks woodland graves. Then medicinal, again, a lot can be talked about the medicinal aspects of the mushroom. I did my PhD on medicinal mushrooms. There are a lot of activities are there. The mushrooms are used not only as a food, but as a nutraceuticals, as a immunomodulators, as a adaptogens or immunoboosters, which boosts up your immune system, which activates different cells, natural killer cells or immunoglobulins or cytokinins and all that. And they make your body adapted to the adverse conditions. Plus, you name any ailment, any disease, you have the cure with the mushroom. And these are the some of the medicinal mushroom from the region where I live, Maharashtra, Western Ghats, as well as in Madhya Pradesh. So that is Phalaenus merrilii. My PhD is based on this mushroom. Then Ganoderma lucidum, Phallus impudicus, Xyathus, which is called bird net fungus, Lycopodon bovista. You can read the medicinal importances. Then Xylaria, Astraeus, Scleroderma, Microporus. There are many more candidates are there. And this is general activity, medicinal activity, like antibacterial, anti-candida, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, anti-tumor, blood pressure lowering, antiviral, and so on and so forth, liver tonic, etc. So you have the different mushrooms working on different ailments. Then the colors, various pigments are extracted, which are used in the dye industry, textile industry, in the food industry. And with one of my students, we are working to build the dye-sensitized solar cell. So these pigments can be used to, you know, synthesize solar cells. They can use the solar energy and convert it into electric energy. So we are working on that. Of course, a lot of candidates have been worked out, different synthetic dyes are used, the pigments from the plants are used, and we are working on the pigments from the fungi. So the cotton or wool dyeing is made. Now this is another aspect. This is Phallus impudicus. If you see the phallus, it is very delicate fungus. It lasts only for a few hours and then it perishes off. But in one of the papers, they mentioned that this phallus came out breaking the hard asphalt road. And they calculated the force that was exerted by this mushroom. And it is calculated that the mushroom exerted very powerful force, which can lift, or three of such mushrooms can lift approximately 400 kgs. But if you see the mushroom for real, this right hand side we have collected from Mahabaleshwar, that is a hill station in Maharashtra. There is a place called Lingmada. There is a waterfall, and near that waterfall we have collected this mushroom. So it is a very delicate mushroom and it emits awful odor. Again, there is another research which perhaps I would like to share. One of my friend, Dr. John Holliday from the Hawaii, he worked on the aphrodisiac nature of this mushroom, because it emits such a odor that may give rise to the or which consider as aphrodisiac. Anyway, so you can have such mushroom lamps. These are bioluminescent mushrooms. Recently, in Meghalaya, one of the species of such bioluminescent mushrooms has been discovered. Now, these genes are isolated and they are cloned to detect the cancer cells, or maybe in World War I, there is an interesting story I can share. If there is a platoon, and in Vietnam War, suppose the soldiers from the same platoon get dispersed in the dark. So how to recognize a soldier, whether it is from the same platoon or whether it is a enemy? So what they would do, the soldiers, they put such bioluminescent fungi on their helmet. And if a person see, oh, this is a bioluminescent mushroom, that means he's from my platoon. So that was interesting story. Then using the mushrooms, the Egyptian crowns were designed. So this is very interesting paper, another paper. So this is how, this is mushroom primordia, and look at the shape of mushroom primordia and look at the crown of the kings, or this is the group. This is a psilocybe cubensis. And look at the symbol of jewelry, like this was designed. Or this is Amanita, this is also Amanita. Then psilocybe, stropharia, and see how a resemblance is there. Then such hallucinogenic mushrooms, they are also used in the criminal investigation. So this is a book describing such uses. Now, a very hardcore criminal would not speak very easily, even if you beat or even if you torture that criminal. So under the supervision of a psychiatrist and doctor, what they did, they extracted the compound which is responsible for the hallucination, that is psilocybin. And they gave the psilocybin to the criminal in a controlled dose. So this psilocybin, it is thought that it breaks your ego and the person starts speaking the truth. So to solve the crime or to get the information, such studies were done. But of course, in not only in America, in most of the countries, now it is considered to be offensive. If you found growing psilocybe, or if you found containing the material which is used for the growing this mushroom, it is an offense, serious offense. Then you can make the papers from the mushroom mycelia. And they found that the Trematis versicolor, Ganoderma, Homeotopsis are the good choices for the handmade paper. Recently, maybe last week, there was a news that the Stanford University designers and researchers, they made the bricks out of the mushroom mycelia. And they found is they are more stronger than the concrete bricks. So they called it as a mycotexture, 6x6 mushroom bricks from the Ganoderma lucidum. Then this is a leather, wagon leather or muskin, which they call. It is an alternate to the animal hide or animal leather. And these are the different objects, purses and hats and caps that were made. And you can have it on the chair or sofa likewise. And I would like all of you to read this very interesting, you can say, poem or thought, which is given by a Mazatec shaman, Maria Sabina. She is not, she is no more, but there is a world beyond ours, a world that is far away, nearby and invisible. And there is where God lives, where the dead lives, the spirits of the saints, a world where everything has already happened, and everything is known. The world talks and it has a language of its own. I report what it says. The sacred mushroom takes me by and hand and brings me to the world where everything is known. It is they, the sacred mushrooms, that speaks in a way I can understand. I ask them and they answer me. When I return from the trip that I have taken with them, I tell what they have told me and what they have shown. And this is very much true and very much complementing the title of today's topic. So with this, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And I hope you might have enjoyed this. Thank you. So shall I switch off my presentation?
Yes, Dr. Prasad. Okay, thank you, Dr. Prasad, for your excellent and informative talk. You have explained clearly about the myths, including the microphilia and mysteries, Iceman, with attractive contents and also the pictures showing us the architectures around the world. And we also know more about the Indian culture and are more aware about the applications of mushrooms in ancient world and modern world in various fields such as medication and criminal investigation. Thank you very much, Dr. Prasad. Now we will start our Q&A session. So participants can take this opportunity to ask questions and clarify your doubts. You may either type your questions in the chat box or unmute yourself and start talking. So we have our Dean of Faculty of Applied Science, Dr. Prof. Ravi.
Yeah,
Does you have any question to ask?
Yeah, actually I'm a botanist and I'm a fan of fungus. And very nice to see the reference of Alexopolis and nymphs that which I used to refer during my studies. And I just want to tell dear students, very, very rare to see mycologists nowadays. Very rare species and people don't want to study. And now let's say if I find some unusual fungus and very difficult to identify, I think it's very nice to have Dr. Prasad Lambrod. I think I really enjoyed your talk. And actually you really enjoyed your research, the way you spoke and you really enjoyed what you have done. I think life is all about it. And I have two questions and one request. How do you identify mushroom? Do you use any PCR-based identification based on ribosomal, 18S ribosomal RNA ITS region?
Okay. There are two aspects are there. That is, conventional aspect is there are field keys are there or scientific keys are there. You take the sections, you study the spores, basidia, mycelial structure, various cystidia. You measure them, micrometry them, and then compare the characters with that of the standard keys that are given. That is one, which is commonly used. And now the science is switching over to the molecular phylogeny, where you can have the 5.8 RNA or ITS sequence, ITS1 or ITS2, and then you can construct phylogram.
Yeah.
And you can identify, you can establish the relationship. And this is what is going on nowadays.
Yeah. That's the way, because I used to work with the clinician, particularly eye specialist. And when the patient have an infection in the eye, they do not know it's a fungal infection or bacterial infection. So they approached me and I used to do this ITS PCR, you know, that 18S rRNA primer, and then we blast and tell them, okay, it's a fungal. Then they will start treating the patient with the antifungal agent. They save a lot of people with the eye infection.
Yes.
And I think it's very good. And I still remember my lactophenol cotton blue smear.
Okay.
It's very nice to see, and they have now new stains, calcofluor stain and other stain to identify the hyphae of the fungus. Go ahead.
Floxin is used or Congored is used. Yeah. So there are different stains are there. You can stain the clamp connections or Chylocystidia or Purocystidia. So there are different stains are used. Mm. But basically, cotton blue is a choice.
Yeah, it's a very, very interesting area. I was thinking a small project for APSA with Mr. Hugo's permission. We have a lot of fungus. Actually, we are living in a real tropical rainforest, and we have extreme weather, and we have all kind of fungus in the campus, starting from a ball shape to whatever shape, and giant mushroom, and we see all kind of things. Mm-hmm. I think we APSA has a lot of students, and they can snap the picture, and at least we can come up with a book of Ames mushrooms or fungus, whatever I was thinking. We can make a small PDF file as a book, electronic book we can come up with. I think all of you go to the phone and then try to capture the fungus. And Dr. Prasad can help us to identify based on the picture.
Yeah, sure. I'll be honored.
Yeah. We can have a joint publication. Dr. Shubhas is very good in that.
Yes.
Yeah, so I think it is an unknown. It's an unknown area. If you want to really go and find somebody, it's very rare to find someone who can identify a fungus. I always send to Dr. Shubhas, if I find something, you know, we'll try to search Google and identify. I think it's good to have a small collection of fungus in Ames University. And with your help, Dr. Prasad, I think we really, it's a nice, challenging interesting work to do at this challenging time of pandemic.
Yes. Certainly.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you,
yeah. Prof. Ravi, and thank you, Dr. Shivas. So at the moment, when Dr. Prasad was answering the Prof. Ravi questions, so we have another question from one of our participants. The question is, why there is no effective mushroom-based treatments against cancer and other pathologies are described in Occidental medicines. So Dr. Prasad, may you share your thoughts with us? Thank you.
The question is why there is no effective mushroom-based treatments against cancer and other pathologies are prescribed in
Occidental medicine.
There are various mushrooms are there which are used against the cancer and tumor. Of course, modern science may not accept herbal based treatment because allopathy's way of thinking is different. But like I said, Ganoderma lucidum is very well used in China. Now it has been used in India also. Even DXN, which is a Malaysia-based company, which is producing a lot of products, right from the toothpaste to the tablets. They are sold even in Ahmednagar, where the place I live. They are available in Pune. So it's not like that. In Japan, Lentinula iodis, which is the medicinally or medically approved drug, polysaccharide. So there are various mushrooms that are there. Maybe in a days to come, we will have such products. The allopathy practitioners, they are prescribing such mushrooms. Yes, there are. Is it satisfied, the answer?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Prasad, for your sharing.
The DXN is very close to us, our place. Yes. Yeah, in the same state. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Prasad. I'm checking my chat box. So while waiting others to ask the questions, maybe may I ask some questions from Dr. Prasad? So Dr. Prasad, as you mentioned just now, that the mushroom is one of the food to help slowing the aging. So as we know that fungus has a mechanism that helps to protect its DNA from damage, so giving it one of the most stable genomes in the natural world. So may I know that is the mechanism can be applied to human genome as well by using the DNA technology or rDNA technology?
I'm sorry, your voice was cutting, so I could not get your question properly.
Yeah, yes. May you hear me, Dr. Prasad?
Yes.
Yes, Dr. Prasad, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear.
I repeat the question again. May I repeat my question again, Dr. Prasad?
Yes, please.
Hi, yes, sorry for the connection problems. Dr. Prasad, as you mentioned just now that the mushroom is one of the food to help slowing the aging. So as we know that fungus has a mechanism that helps to protect its DNA from damage and giving it one of the most stable genomes in the natural world. So may I know that this mechanism can be applied in the human genome as well by using the DNA technology or rDNA technology?
You want to ask me the mushrooms, they protect the DNA?
Yes.
Huh. So can we use the mushroom?
In our human genome, the technique can be used in our human genome.
So you want to know whether mushroom gene can be incorporated in the human DNA?
Yes.
To protect
from our human genome, yes.
Such study I have not come across. What I have come across that the different extracts of the mushrooms, they are used as an antioxidant to reduce the stress. Yeah, na? So at least I have not come across such study. Maybe it may be used, I am not sure. But at least you can use the different mushroom extract as a antioxidant and you can have your life prolonged to reduce the stress.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Prasad, for your answering. And my second question is, I saw an article published last year by the NASA team that highlights the mushroom presence with the image from the surface of Mars. So please, can you tell us that what's the reason and sources that support the growth of mushrooms on that planet? And if the mushroom and fungus can survive there, does it mean that there's a high probability that other organisms such as animals, insects, and humans can live there too? So please share your thoughts with us, Dr. Prasad.
You read the article last week or last time. Actually, that paper appeared in 2014, about 6 years ago. And it was, it raised a lot of controversies. There was a picture published showing mushroom-like structures on the surface of the Mars or puffball-like structures, of course, to which the NASA has not supported. And even one of the authors said that they do not have concrete evidences to state that whether they are really mushrooms or stones. Because these photographs were taken by the rovers, maybe Opportunity or some other rover. So the scientists did not went there to collect the mushroom and see the mycelia and etc. Based on the morphological aspect, they claim that these could be mushroom. But as for now, we know that the planet Mars is a dry. There is no water, there is no life that is there. And what scientists are saying, these are actually not mushrooms, or what NASA has released, that these are not mushrooms, but these are actually the iron ores or hematite, the balls of hematite, and which to which they call them as the blueberries. And fortunately, maybe last week I was watching History TV 18, and there was some program was on there on Mars. And one scientist, a lady scientist, she mentioned about such blueberries. And we can find such blueberries or the iron ores, hematite, in maybe Arizona desert or something like that. So it was analogy that these are not mushrooms or puffball, but these are iron ores, hematite. Because, and even if they, the NASA would not disclose very easily. Because a few years back, there was a photograph that went viral showing one humanoid sitting on a rock. And everybody started saying, oh, this is a human which is there on the Mars. But the NASA denied and said that this is just a shadow. Even human face-like structure was there. So again, they say that these are the mountain ranges and you can see the shadow effect. And because of which it appears as of the human being. So there are many pressures and politics are...
Yes, Dr. Praza. Dr. Praza, may you hear me?
Hello?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, Dr. Praza. Yeah, your line connection has a little bit problem just now. You may continue your sharing your thoughts.
No, I have given the answer. Is it satisfying?
Yeah, for sure. Thank you, Dr. Praza, for clearing my doubts now. So,
and even if you want to know whether there is a bacteria or fungi are there on the Mars, you have to go to the Mars, collect the soil, bring it to EMS, do the serial dilution, plate it, and identify.
Maybe in future, I hope that I have the opportunity to do that. So,
sure, so I'll be glad to accompany you.
Thank you, Dr. Praza. So we have other questions from our participants now. One of the questions is, can mushroom be grafted like other plants?
No, they cannot. Because mushrooms are not plants. They do not have xylem and phloem and pericycle and endodermis, nothing. These are the mycelia. And nobody has done ever.
Okay. Thank you,
they
Dr.
cannot
Praza.
Be grafted or cultured.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Praza, for answering the question. The second question is, how to identify a mushroom type, whether it is poisonous or not?
Yes, this is much awaited and much expected question. Because everywhere I hear this question, how to identify the poisonous and edible mushroom. Of course, there is no concrete protocol as such. Even if you search on the net, most of them, they will speak that you have to have the experience and then and only you can identify the mushroom. Of course, there are some old if you doubt about a mushroom, then take a bucket of water, put the mushroom, put an iron rod or a silver article, and then boil the water. And if the water turns blue or green, or if the silver article turns black, then that is a poisonous mushroom, whereas others are not. Second taboo, or you can say misconception, is there. They said that the edible mushrooms, they grow on the grassland in an open area where there is a sun. But that is also not true. Agaricus bisporus has same habitat. And one of the poisonous mushroom, Agaricus xanthodermus, which is exactly look like a Agaricus bisporus, which is poisonous and which grows on the same habitat. So another thing, they say that the light colored mushrooms are edible, whereas dark color mushrooms are poisonous. That is also not true. Auricula jedi, which is a dark brown or black in color, which is excellent edible, whereas Agaricus xanthodermus is totally white in color, which is poisonous. But maybe a week or two ago, I came across with a paper where they have used artificial neural network. They converted the some characters of mushroom into computer language, and they came up with some ratio, and they said that if the ratio is this much, then the mushroom may be edible. If the ratio is lower or higher, the mushroom may be poisonous. But again, we have to check it out with different kinds of mushroom, whether it is true or false. But artificial neural network may solve the problem of identification. There are some chemical tests are there, like ferric oxide, or if you cut the mushroom, if it turns blue, then that may be poisonous. And poisonous does not mean that if you eat and you instantly die. No, that is another misconception. I have consumed a lot of mushrooms over these years and I'm still alive and giving you talk.
Thank you, Dr. Faza, for answering. Interesting sharing. So there are more questions from our chat box now. So I would like to pick some of the questions because we are running out of time. So the question is, there's a Dr. Abhe Salvi sharing her or his appreciation to you, Dr. Prasad. So he thanks Dr. Prasad for sharing and also the organizer. And the question from Dr. is, the silver spoon test is authentic to test the poisonous and non-poisonous mushroom. Is it the test possible to be used?
It can be used, but I cannot say that it is authentic. Because anyway, silver will get oxidized if you expose it to the moisture. Isn't it? And maybe I have also tried this, but I could not get the oxidation or any turning of water into blue or green or any. So I cannot say that this is the authentic or not.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Prasad, and hope Dr. Prasad may answer your questions. So I'm checking now the chat box, and I want to pass the message from our participants to you, Dr. Prasad. And there's a lot of appreciation from the participants, and they were saying it's a very informative talk and excellent presentation by you, Dr. Prasad. So we also have our professor, Dr. Subhash here. Does he have any question to ask?
Yeah, thank you, Ms. Chai. Dr. Prasad, while talking, you mentioned about role of mushrooms in immunomodulation.
Yes.
So that one triggered my thought, because now everybody is thinking how to boost the immune system, you know, because of COVID-19. So my question is, if we eat mushrooms regularly, will it help us to boost our immune system and become better, in this challenging situation, because everywhere there are cases of COVID-19, increasing in every country. So what do you think as a mycologist, Dr. Prasad?
Certainly. I'm eating the mushroom on a regular basis. I can share my personal experience. Like a few years ago, my mother had the hepatitis A. And later on, she developed some problem with her liver. I was doing a PhD then. So what I did, I collected the Ganoderma from the university. I made extract, alcoholic extract in wine and water. And I started giving her. And to my surprise, she recovered. This is first-hand experience. Even one of my students, he has started taking extract of Phalaenus on a regular basis. And yesterday only he called me and said that he has some positive benefits. Plus, we are after making a homeopathic medicine from the Phalaenus, and we got a good result. They are under the scrutiny and the statistical analysis. Maybe we'll publish that later on. So certainly I will recommend the mushrooms on a regular basis, but not in excess, of course.
Okay. Another question I have, Dr. Prasad, because, for example, we are closing the house, locking the house and going for holiday. Nowadays we are at home almost 1 year, but on a regular basis when there is no pandemic. So when we go for 1 month or 2 months holiday and come back, our house, once we come back, it will be full of the fungal spores, you know? So, when we get exposed, sometimes we will have some sickness, or we'll have, deadly, but we'll have some symptoms. So would you elaborate, in sense of the load of the fungal spores, at least how many spores we should have to get fall sick or something like this one means load of the fungal spores which makes the people sick.
Oh, this is a bit tricky question. I have no data on that, but exact spore load I do not know, but that depends on the again person's immunity. If you are a sensitive enough, even a single spore can infect you. And if your immunity is more, you can survive in a you had been to my place and you have seen my place, so I can survive because my immunity is more.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prasad. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Subhash, and thank you, Dr. Prasad. So there's other question from the chat box now, and the question are almost the same. And Dr. Prasad has shared the thoughts and the techniques to detect the poisonous level of the mushrooms. So any further question from participants? Because actually we are running out of time and I'm going to end the Q&A session. Participant can take this last opportunity to ask the last question by unmuting yourself. And I will wait a few moments for the participants, please.
Yeah, I can see one or two questions in my chat box. One question is, can mushroom infect human like caterpillar fungus? I will say that instead of mushroom, the fungus, there are fungi are there which infects the human being. Yes, there are dermatophytic fungi are there like trichophyton, epidermophyton and microsporum, which commonly causes the dermatitis, plus candida albicans is there, which causes the candidiasis. Aspergillus is there, which causes aspergillosis. So there are, yes, certain fungi are there. And about the caterpillar fungus, it belongs to the Ascomycotina. Omphiocordyceps or Cordyceps militaris or Cordyceps sinensis, which grows on the insects. But there are, yes, fungi are there, which causes the infection in humans. Serious infections are there. Mild infections are also there.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Prasad, for your patient answering. So any further question from our participants?
I can see a few more questions.
Yes, there's other questions. So it, what types of, Dr. Prasad, here's the question from our participants. It is asking that what type of mushroom are recommended harvesting at home?
I can suggest mushrooms which are very easy to grow at home, even in the balcony or even in the terrace. One mushroom is a Pleurotus. You can grow any species of Pleurotus except Pleurotus tuberosium. That can be grown very easily. That can be harvested and it is very tasty. And another mushroom is Wolveriella wolbachia. If you want to go for Agaricus bisporus, there is a lot of technicality that is involved. Of course, one of my friends and my mentor, Dr. Arvind Rabba, if he's here or no, I don't know. But he has developed a technique where you can cultivate Agaricus bisporus in a much less expenses. But for now, Pleurotus and Wolveriella, you can harvest and you can cultivate at home. Okay, are the mushrooms growing in the yard are dangerous to my pets? Usually they are not, because the dogs, they love the mushrooms, which are basically we get in supermarkets. And again, that depends on what is your pet. If fox is your pet, then I have seen the photographs of a fox eating Amanita muscaria, which is a poisonous. If a snail is your pet, then snails can eat mushrooms very easily. If monkey is your pet, monkeys do eat mushrooms. If bird is your pet, the bird eat mushrooms. They use the mushroom for the nest building. If a rabbit is your pet, yes, rabbits easily eat the mushrooms, even the poisonous mushrooms. But if you are talking about the dogs, the dog prefer to eat the edible mushrooms. I have not seen or came across any reference where the cat is, or a donkey or pig is eating mushroom.
Thank you, Dr. Prasad, for your answering. So I'm the chatbot. I come up with a lot of comments and the appreciation from our participants. They say, thanks for the information, sir. And indeed, excellent presentation and information. Thank you very much, Dr. Prasad. So any question for our participants? So basically we have a participant from different countries. So please feel free to unmute yourself and ask the questions and it will be great. So participant, please take opportunity, especially a student for biotechnology at Ames University. Please grab your chance to ask the questions from our professor.
Yeah, while waiting for others to ask question, maybe I can give some interesting fact about these quadriceps. Dr. Prasad, you have any experience on quadriceps? The fungus which infect a caterpillar, the caterpillar go to the top of a tree and then create the spore forming body, and it supposedly has some anti-cancer and better effects.
Yes, enhancing activity.
Yeah.
The cordyceps extract has been given to some Chinese sportsmen which performed very well.
Yeah.
We are wondering why the performance was high. Were they on drugs or steroids? Then it was revealed that the cordyceps was given. And it is exported or rather smuggled to the China from the Tibet, highlands of the Tibet. And 1 kg of mushroom will cost you maybe 5 lakh rupees.
Yeah.
In gray market. And the area where the cordyceps sinensis is growing is protected by the armed persons. And if you are found trespassing illegally, you will be shot dead. So you need to have the permit to collect the cordyceps sinensis. Of course, there are many species are there, but basically cordyceps sinensis is largely used. Now the name has been changed to Ophiocordyceps.
Ophiocordyceps, okay. It is very interesting. If you see, if you search quadriceps, you can see a National Geography video and how it invades a worm, nematode, and then it controls its mind and it goes to a, and then it will, actually it invades the whole worm. And it goes to the top of a tree and then make a fruit-forming bodies, sporulating bodies.
There are many species are there of cordyceps which grows on spiders, ants.
Yeah. It can somehow control their minds.
Fire mushroom, it is called.
Yeah. They take over the worms.
And it kills the insect and then it forms the fruit body.
Will form the fruiting bodies, yeah.
Yes, Prof. Ravi.
It's fine. Just want to stimulate people. Yeah. Everyone is very quiet, and it is a very interesting story how a fungus take over a worm and then how it grows on it.
Only with the cordyceps, I have many interesting stories with about other mushrooms also.
Like
to share such interesting stories.
We can have, hopefully our team can identify new, maybe we have a better undiscovered mushroom in our jungle.
Yeah, Dr. Prasad, we are welcome you to come to our university to have a trip together with us.
Sure. Welcome, hopefully all the pandemic settles down.
Yes.
Next year, 2021 will be good for everyone.
Let's hope so.
So thank you, Prof. Ravi and Dr. Prasad. So if there's no, so I didn't see any question in the chat box. So actually it is a very interactive session until now. And if there's no any question, I assume that all the questions are answered. And thank you participants, Prof. Ravi, Dr. Shubhas and others for take part in the Q&A session. So thank you participants for asking the relevant questions and interactively participate through the whole sessions of the webinar. So once again, thank you, Dr. Prasad, for the interactive talk, excellent talk, and for your sharing with us. So I'm sure that everyone will agree that we all had a fantastic session together. And it is a very fruitful talk and interactive session. So thanks to the organizing committee for the wonderful job. And this was my first time in life to serve as the moderator. I need to mention that I really enjoy it. And last but not least, I want to deliver my special thanks to Dr. Shubhas for training me. All right, ladies and gentlemen, just a few days to go, we have a brand new year. In advance, I wish you all a very happy new year 2021. Reno, over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Informative Talk. And thank you very much, Ms. Chai Hoichi, for moderating the session. Without further ado, I would like to invite Ms. Yamuna for a note of thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Reno. Hello, everyone. I'm Yamuna, and I'm proud to tell you that I'm a student of BSc Honors in Biotechnology Degree Program at Ames University. I believe that this webinar helped you to get some insight and learn something new about mushrooms. On behalf of APSA and Webinar Organizing Committee, I want to thank Dr. Prasad for enlightening and informative talk on mushroom, taboo, myth, mystery, and beyond. We are grateful for the time and effort you took to share your thoughts and experience with us. We appreciate it. Thank you, Prof. M. Ravichandran, the Dean of Faculty of Applied Sciences, for attending our webinar. I would also like to thank all the participants for joining us for this webinar. Besides, I want to take this opportunity to thank each member of the organizing team for their efforts to make this webinar a success. Finally, on behalf of the organizing committee and AIMS Biotechnology Student Association, I want to thank Dr. Subhash for training us. Once again, thank you everyone for making this webinar a success. Ms. Renu, over to you.
Thank you, Ms. Yamuna. It was a great session today. Before ending this session, we would like to hear feedback from all participants by scanning the code on the screen right now. We promise the evaluation survey will not take you more than 1 minute. Your feedback will be greatly appreciated. You can scan the QR code or go to the link shown below. The link is posted in the chat box as well. After the completion of the survey, you will receive an instant participation certificate in a short while. And I will keep this slide running for 2 more minutes for you to scan the QR code. We're looking forward to have all of you join us again in the next session. Thank you again, everyone, and we wish you good health and safety. I hope everyone have the chance to scan the QR code, and I'm going to end the meeting. See you soon in our next webinar. Stay safe and have a wonderful day. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you, Dr. Prasad, Prof. Ravi, and Dr. Shubhas. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.